What most people refer to as tonsils are known as palatine tonsils. These are the two large protruding tissues that reside on the sides of the back of your throat. These are actually part of a grouping of lymphoid tissues, tissues that perform different functions for your immune system, known as Waldeyer's tonsillar ring. Waldeyer's ring creates a rough circular edge at the opening of our digestive system. Encompassing both the nasopharynx, the space where your nose meets the back of your throat, and the oropharynx, the back of your throat itself, it creates a barrier of sorts. It's the first point of contact our immune system has with the bacteria and microbes that we ingest or inhale. While the palatine tonsils are the largest part of Waldeyer's ring, the other parts include the pharyngeal tonsil, also known as the adenoids, Gerlach's tonsils, which are at the opening between your nasopharynx and your middle ear, known as your eustachian tubes, and the lingual tonsils, which are the tissues that reside on the base of your tongue. Your lymphatic system has many responsibilities that intertwine with each other. Its main responsibility is to collect and transport fluid from all of the intercellular spaces of the body, known as the interstitial fluid, back to the bloodstream. It's also responsible for transporting digested fats and large molecules like enzymes and hormones from the places they are created to the bloodstream. The other thing the lymphatic system does, in reference to the tonsils, is create antibodies that help in building an immunity to infectious diseases. They also help filter out smaller bacteria and toxins. So, to answer the question specifically, the tonsils' job in this web of logistical functions is to create antibodies, immunoglobulins. Most active between the ages of 4 and 10, they have been observed creating a type of lymphocyte, a type of white blood cell known as a B cell. There are several different types of these cells, and they are programmed to make specific antibodies. One type might make an antibody for bacteria that causes pneumonia, while another might make an antibody for a variant of the so-called common cold. Once created by the tonsils, these B cells will move to the mucus in your upper airway, salivary, and lacrimal glands. When it comes into contact with a source that will trigger it, like a specific microbe, it will trigger larger plasma cells to produce more antibodies. Given this evolutionary barrier to bacterial attack seems like a very good thing, you might now be wondering why at one time was everybody born within earshot of the doctor seemingly having these things removed. The biggest reason for removing your tonsils used to be due to recurring infection. This usually occurs between the ages of 4 and 10 when they are most active. By the age of 11, your tonsils will begin to shrink and the chance of them becoming infected lessens. One of the main culprits causing your tonsils problems is the Streptococcus bacterium, that's strep throat, and many people can get numerous tonsil infections, even several times per year. Before the advent of modern antibiotics, removing them from the equation was the best treatment for reducing the chance of this painful chronic condition. The fact that there were relatively low complication rates to tonsillectomy helped make this procedure commonplace until relatively recently. With the introduction of a myriad of antibiotics, it now has become easier to treat tonsillitis with antibiotics as opposed to surgery. As one Dr. Chris Johnson states, "I first trained and practiced as a pediatric infectious disease specialist, and I was consulted many times about such children, tonsillitis patients. My bias was nearly always against tonsillectomy. My reason, shared by most infectious disease experts, was that we have effective antibiotics to treat strep. Why risk the surgery?" Further, in 2002, one Dr. Tom Marshall published the effectiveness of tonsillectomies in the Oxford Journal's Family Practice. In it, he laid out why tonsillectomies are slowly becoming a thing of the past for treating recurrent tonsillitis. In the only controlled trial that demonstrated the effectiveness of tonsillectomies at the time, only 25% of patients who had one performed on them met the criteria recommended. In response to this glaring oversight on many doctors' parts, he stated, "Perhaps the simplest solution to this problem is to tell patients the truth. A child who meets these strict criteria will probably suffer from 6 throat infections in the next 2 years. A child who has had the surgery will now probably suffer 3 throat infections. In 2 years, there will probably be no difference." That said, for those who have had their tonsils removed and are now wondering why you had to be subjected to the loss of an antimicrobial superpower, perhaps for no good reason, it turns out that most people have no increase in the risk of other body infections when the tonsils are removed. This is why it's still a common procedure for afflictions like recurring tonsillitis that does not respond to antibiotics. Further, there are some other things, like a tonsil abscess that doesn't respond to drainage, large tonsils that can affect nighttime breathing, or indeed tumors of the tonsils. These can all be good reasons for having them cut out. As in just about everything in medicine, and, well, in life, there are no perfect solutions. It's simply a balancing of pros and cons given a particular course of action. And now for a bonus fact. Tonsils contain pockets on them. When we eat or drink, bacteria, dead cells, mucus, and other materials can become trapped in these pockets. Over time, this concentrated debris can become calcified and become what is known as a tonsillolith or a tonsil stone. If you've ever wondered what those white chunks are at the back of your throat, well, now you know. They're a bit gross and they smell awful, but in most cases, they aren't really a big deal. So I really hope you found that video interesting. Hopefully we answered that question for you. If you did, please do give us a thumbs up below and don't forget to subscribe. Also, we've recently relaunched our merch line. You can find that link to below. Also, we're working with a really cool company and we'd like to know if you've got crazy ideas, or maybe not crazy, just good ideas would be better. Good ideas for merch. Go over to Twitter, follow me at Simon Whistler, and message me or do the tagging thing. I should work on my Twitter lingo and say hi and send me your idea, and I will look them over and see what we can do. And as always, thank you for watching.